So there are no faults in that sense, if you don't define it as a fault. So what we're looking at here is trying to transcend or break through our cultural habit of finding fault with the world when it doesn't meet our belief system. How, you know, the room should be cooler, it should be hotter. You know, this should not, you know, whatever, that's a very immediate thing, or this chair should not be as, should be more comfortable, or LOI should have done something with this or that, you know, and it's always finding something, and then that goes into the next layers, you know, well then something's wrong with Richmond, or something's wrong with my neighbors, or something's wrong with the politics, or something's wrong with America, or something's wrong with humanity, we're a mistake, you know, so. And there's no end to that, you see. You just keep going on and on, you know. So anyway, let's, we'll start with, you remember the movie, The Close Encounter of a Third Kind? What was that? I can't remember what was it, about a spaceship?
Yeah, this guy got obsessed with finding the spaceship.
Oh, he made this.
Mashed potato spaceship.
Yeah,
good.
Yeah. Didn't he make a mountain or something?
Yeah.
And he had
landed on. He made the mountain.
He made Devil's Cliff or something like that.
Yeah, but he made a little mountain. He didn't know what he was doing, and he made this thing, and it turned. Or getting back to the inner, the microcosm, which is the individual world, the inner, my subjective world, and the macrocosm, which is the external world. So this was kind of like a magic event where he was like witchcraft, you know, or voodoo or something, where you make a little doll and you can stick a pin in the doll and the person the doll is at hurts where the pin is. Well, you know, we think this is poo-poo. So I was reading where primitive societies are magical societies and they live and this works. For instance, there was a report some archaeologist or some anthropologist, and he was living with some pygmies in a very, very aboriginal tribe who were in Africa, and they were hunters, they were hunter society. And he said, will you kill a gazelle so we can have some dinner? And they thought, well, this is no small operation. So they had to, I forgot what they went through a ritual where they had to sing, and then they drew a picture of a gazelle on the ground, and then they shot an arrow into the picture where they wanted to hit the gazelle, and then in the morning, after they completed the all up all night or something, they went up and shot the gazelle exactly where the arrow hit the picture. You know, so they were living in a compatible relationship with the universe that we don't live in anymore. We are severed and cut off from nature, and we live in a technological, industrial, digital machine society, and we don't live in nature. We can live without nature. We don't need the sun. We've got lights. We don't need the cooling breeze. We've got AC. You know, we're pretty much secure. We've pretty much insulated ourselves from bugs. Don't have to worry about them. You know, nature's irritant, whatever. We're almost to the point where we're eating artificial food, which is, you know, there's a lot of revolt against that. I hope I'm not wandering too much, but my wife gets passionate. She's always done this about particular new diets, you know. So we used to be vegetarians. We were vegetarian for 10 years, and then there was vegetarian cookbooks, and then we'd fall off that. We'd stop doing that, and we'd go back to Southside Virginia food. I don't know, whatever, you know, whatever, you know. And then we would get an inspiration to go back. You know, so 10 years. So anyway, when my uncle came to visit, we went off our vegetarian wagon and went to. Everyday meat and potatoes thing, because that's what he ate. But now, since he left, My wife really got excited about the paleo diet. So the paleo diet basically is a, it's almost like a intermediate diet between just regular American food and whatever you get at Walmart, you know, whatever you eat, and vegetarianism. You know, so it's kind of like cuts down the middle, because the paleo diet is a meat-eating diet. However, you just eat fresh vegetables and fruit, organic if possible, so you don't eat any wheat, dairy, or beans. So the vegetables and fruit, cantaloupe and vegetables, all the fresh vegetables, spinach, kale, a lot of that stuff, you know, carrots and all that, but no wheat. And the logic behind it is because the wheat has been corrupted through industrialization, so the wheat that we're eating today is not the same wheat that the Paleolithic people ate. See. So it's kind of like the idea is going back to Paleolithic is the diet of the hunting age, before the planting age. You know, so the Paleolithic is kind of like the idea behind it is to go back to the original diet. You know. She's. I'm trying to think why I got into this particular tale. How do I get out? All right, so, all right, it'll come back to me.
You were talking about artificial food. Did that make any of the point? You were saying our food is becoming...
This is a big political thing with Monsanto or whatever, you know, because this is a company that is creating artificial seeds and plants, you know, to produce, to have certain qualities, but in time all of the natural foods are threatened, you know, as this artificial thing comes in, and nobody knows really what the all of the different effects can be to this, because there's no way to figure out all of the variable effects that can happen when you start messing with nature. But the whole idea in the West is that you can fix nature. We can improve on nature. And more we find out that for every improvement we make, there is an equal unimprovement that surprises us. Where did that come from? You know. So what was my encounter? Oh, the third kind, okay. Encounter of the third kind, magic, mountain, and it came to pass in the spaceship and all that. Okay, so encounter of a third time. So anyway, so I had an encounter with, in the third kind, I had an encounter with death. So we were coming back from Cambridge, which is the town where my son lives over in the next town over. We were coming back, it's a two-lane road. And it was night, and so we're driving along back, just like you always do, everyday normal. So you're going along here, okay, so you're riding along in your personality. Driving, you know, we're going home. You're going somewhere. You've been somewhere. Maybe you listen to the music. Maybe you're just sitting there thinking your thoughts. You know. And so another car was coming, and it was night, and so headlights coming, and so on and on. And so I guess when he was about right there, he just drifted. I don't know whether he fell asleep or he was drunk, but he drove right into my lane, so he was coming right at me. So we were like, a head-on collision. And so the next thing I know, I remember seeing the headlights in front of, right in front of me, you know. So I remember recognizing that there were headlights in front of me. And the next thing I know, we're here, and I'm aware of two sounds. I'm aware of the car, the other car, rushing by me right here, like a freight train, boom. And on this side, I heard the sound of the tires and the gravel and the weeds. And I don't know if there was, I don't know what was on that side of the road or anything, you know, if there was a ditch, I didn't see that. And so then it was like, boom, and then I'm back on the road, and then my personality comes back. And the personality says, what the fuck was that, you know? Yeah. Or did you see that? So I question, you know, so there's thinking here, right? And there's thinking here. But here. There's no thinking. There's no personality looking around saying, you know, oh wow, you know. There's no personality. And I've heard this came to my mind. But I've always, in Zen and all these things, they all, you know, the mystical writings, you know, what is between two thoughts, you know, that, you know, the stillness, the ground of being, your true self is between two thoughts. What the hell does that mean? You know, because you sit and meditate, thoughts come by, and I can sit and not think at all, but it's just not thinking, you know, and then the thought will come by. So I've never been able to find the space between two thoughts. And it dawned on me that here it was, because here's thinking, right? It's called the I thought, or the thinking me. And then over here you have the I thinking, that's me, you know, I thinking. So here, but there's no I thinking here. So this is kind of like the space between two thoughts to me. And it didn't take very long to get around, because these cars were going at each other at 55 miles an hour. So it was like, boom, when a car passes you, how long does it take for that car to pass you going in the opposite direction? See? But it was a space that, as I look back on it now and reflect on it, it was an eternal space. Because it was a space between my personality. I was driving. I don't know how I did it. I mean, I have no idea, because there was no... Usually if you're driving and somebody up the road starts drifting, you say, oh, well, I can go to the right or the left. You know, there's time to, you know, the personality can still decide what to do. But at that point, there was no time to decide what to do. So you're just pure doing. You know, so there's nobody doing anything. I don't have the sensation of my driving the car. Yet I was tremendously present. See, so this when and we talk in here, you know, he talks about thinking, welcoming thinking, welcoming feelings, emotions, as guides to your ground of being. Well, here's the ground of being. You know, it was right there. And I'm sure all of us have had some experience in life where you've had a close call of the third kind, you know, where your car skids or something goes on or somebody attacks you or whatever, you know, and you find yourself doing something that you didn't know you could possibly do, or who was doing it, or how did I get out of that, or, yeah.
That what you just described, in 2008, I did. The only difference was the other side there, that I was laying in the street.
Yeah.
And this kid had fallen asleep at his wheel and head on me. And to this day, the only thing I remember about it at the time was this bright light coming at me, like it was a big old black steam engine coming at me.
Yeah.
And my going back like this.
Right.
The funny thing, though, is that...
Well, did he hit you?
He hit me, yeah.
Yeah, well, see, that's a different thing. You didn't do anything.
I didn't, but my wife, I was at 8:30 at night, and my wife was in bed already.
Right.
And she woke up and said she heard me calling.
Yeah.
And said, I need help. And I hadn't done anything. And then the hospital called her and
right.
told her, he's in the hospital, he's alive, he's
right.
okay.
Yeah, yeah.
What comes to mind for me is that, you know, when soldiers come back from war,
yeah.
How difficult it is to readjust to
yeah.
the boring life we live
yeah.
ordinarily.
Back in
and,
that thing here, yeah.
You know, yes, a lot of it, in fact, is the horrors of war, but a
yeah.
lot of it is also that it's living in
yeah.
being alive.
Yeah, there was no horror here. There was no
yeah.
There was no scream. There was no curse. There was nothing. Yeah.
I had an experience like that, not as dramatic, but there's a little curb, and I get, come out of my apartment, go down the street, there's just a little curb, and I
right.
was going a little bit fast.
Right.
And I thought, oh my gosh, I'm going fast. And it's like something grabbed the wheel.
Yeah.
Honestly, I something grabbed the wheel, and I went around it, and I was fine, and as I left there, I thought, what was that?
Right.
What was that?
Right. Well, see, now that comes, all right, see, that's a great point there, because what happens here, this is you're talking about Clint Eastwood and Obama being the empty chair.
Yeah.
Right. This is an empty chair. I mean, you can put anything in there you want. You can put God in there. God took the wheel. My angel took the wheel. Jesus got me out of it. Zeus, Krishna, my guru, you know, whatever you want to put in there, you can put in there because it's an empty blank. But we do have this tendency to refer to something external. You see, this is part of our cultural belief system that really doesn't believe we're greater than we think we are. You see, it's saying, well, I can't, I don't know, I didn't feel like I was driving, so God, I'm alive, so God must have done it, you see. Or Jesus did it, or my angel, or a saint, or somebody, or whatever. You know, so that feeling of not being the doer, when we have, you know, we have to, it doesn't have to be an accident car, but artists, or sports athletes, sex. I mean, there's a lot of situations where you don't feel like you're an artist. You know, you just suddenly, if you get in the zone, your hand starts painting something, and you say, wow, where'd that come from? Or writing, you know, you write something. Wow, you know, that was, you know, who wrote that? I never heard that, you know, where did that come from? Or whatever. Or just saying something, a healing message to somebody when they need it, you know, in a moment of compassion. It wasn't pre-planned, and it wasn't written out in your notebook to do. So there's the feeling of something coming in, call it grace. Okay? And our culture, way back all the way from Genesis, creates the belief system in which matter, flesh, body, stuff, material, is kind of like unintelligent and dead, so God, intelligence, has to come in from outside and activate us. You know, so Yahweh creates the world, he creates man out of clay and blows life into him, you know, sets him up and runs around. But Yahweh, you see in this myth, is outside of nature, something external. Even science believes that. So if this were to move, some external force will have to come in and make that move, like me. So it's everything, power, it has to come from this tradition. I mean, it's not just Buddhism, but yoga and even Christianity, if you read it in the right way, says that that God dwells within. You know, so this power is coming from within. You know, and this practice says, well, it's always within, but we just don't see it because our belief system that we're conditioned in doesn't recognize it. There's no place on our reality map for God to be within. In fact, in Christianity, it's a heresy to say the Father and I are one. I mean, Jesus said it and got crucified. You know, so nobody, anybody, who do you think you are, Jesus? You see, you know, so anytime you come up with something that you know to be true, regardless of belief or evidence or whatever, people will accuse you of being, you know, who do you think you are? How do you know that? You know, what authority do you say that with? You know, what books do you quote? What credentials do you have? What institutional power or credentials do you have to say that, you see? So if you say something from your heart that you know that is contrary to what other people believe is going on, you are immediately questioned as being a heretic. And if you're in the Inquisition in Spain, you get burned. You know, you roast it because you were saying something that's contrary to acceptable knowledge. You see, so our whole system is really built on this idea that that this has to be explained, meaning has to come from some external accepted power or authority, because certainly you don't have that power. You know, you're just a fallen human being. You see, you're just a fallen human, you know. The only power comes from, you know, comes in, you know. So this, what we're saying here is that this I am, this ground of being, is here all the time, and our personality, kind of like floats on it like a bubble. And when we encounter death, the bubble pops. And our whole nature, our full nature, our full being comes into being, you see. And then as soon as it's over, because it's got the inertia, the bubble of personality comes back and I start thinking about what just happened. You see, trying to put it in some kind of a map. Well, it must be something, must be God or something, you see, because that's what everybody says, you see. So, but this, there's no definition here. There's no meaning there. Now, it doesn't mean anything. But, you know, it was life happening, you see. They call this in sports, they call it in the zone. You know, when either an individual or a team gets so in sync that they function as one. Particularly in basketball, you can see this, which is a team sport. And when that team gets in the zone, they're just passing the ball from behind them, and they throw it, and the other guy catches it, not looking at them. They can't get it. They can't not keep it in the basket. You know, that guy, and you feel that, you know. Or individual sports, you know. So the golfer, the master golfer, is always trying to find that sweet spot where he can't miss. You know. So no matter what you do, you know, or whatever. Or the artist, then the artist gets writer's block, you know. And that's when the personality comes in and starts thinking about why they can't write. You know, whatever. They get blocked, you know. Extreme sports. So people chase that experience by intentionally running up against death to see how close you can get to it. You know, so they may plan, you know, but there's always the risk that your plan may go awry because the wind may change, something might break, you know, something may go that you didn't expect, you know, and you could die. So without that risk, you know, there is no empty chairs, but there's no presence. So Eckhart Tolle calls this presence, or now. Okay? See, when we're back in the personality, we're living in time and thought and story. Okay? So our story for the personality, the story of me, is the reality map in which I understand myself. So I understand myself, the meaning I have, by fitting myself and my behavior into a story, my narrative, and it's always in the context of the past. I did this in the past, and I shouldn't do this in the future, so I got this horizontal thing, this time going right like this. But this moment here is this. See, this is now without without this, you know, it's still, but as soon as, so when we come out of this event, like we're going along here, horizontal, time, past, future, I'm going to Blackstone, I've been to Victoria, yada yada, I'm thinking, you know, whatever, thinking, and then suddenly you're dropped out, so suddenly there's this vertical dimension that opens up, and then as soon as you come back here, you're back in the horizontal again. And we think back in memory about this vertical dimension. And then this practice is basically about keeping the vertical dimension as a part of every now, so that now, over here, so this is the horizontal time, past, future, and the vertical now, it's always now. So we're always now thinking about past and future. So past and future then, when this practice begins to bear fruit, in other words, it begins to get some traction, which is what you all are doing by just coming here and listening, you know, trying to figure out what's going on. You know, that this, the opaqueness of the personality begins to become more transparent, and this vertical dimension begins to manifest or be activated or present in our life, you see, because there is no, in this dimension here, there is no definition of life. All the definition of life comes from this dimension, because this is past, this is the known, right? So everything that happens in this dimension of our personality is reference to what I already know. My experiences, what I learned, my vows not to do that, you know, whatever it is, it's all known. But this little section here is unknown. Because there's no personality in there to tell you what's going on. Y'all get a sense of this? I'm using this, you know, as a metaphor to try and like, because it's a common experience that we all have at some point or other. We've all had close encounters. even romantic love. Yeah.
Okay, what is the difference between that and like an adrenaline rush, which I think happened when you saw somebody, you just automatically reacted?
Yeah. Well, then you're saying, yeah.
Or then if someone, like a woman, picks up a car and lifts it off her child, she's not really thinking, she's just acting, but I always thought that was kind of adrenaline.
Yeah, well, see, right there, what you're doing, now, nothing wrong with what you're doing, but what you're doing is that, well, it wasn't God, it was adrenaline. It did. So it's still, it's a chemical. So this would be the scientific way. The religious way would be, oh, God or your angel, guardian angel, or somebody came in and influenced time because you've been a good person. You see, so you know, but then science as well, there's no personal God up there, so it was chemistry. So adrenaline came in and did it. What, there's no difference between adrenaline and God, you see, except in the way we picture, you know, well, we picture a chemical reaction formula, you know, or old guy up in the sky, you know. But either way, it's something external. I didn't do it. The adrenaline did it. So, yeah, for both science and religion have no way of putting this in a map of reality. Because I was definitely, you know, so that's, and like I said, even romantic love is a hole in our space. You know, where you're going along in your horizontal personality and you fall in love and suddenly you've dropped into another dimension. Which does not have any external meaning, because romantic love has meaning unto itself. You know, I mean, that's the love is meaningful, not because something external is making it meaningful. Some definition has no definition. That's why lovers don't want to be, they want to get in a secret grotto. They want to get alone. They want to get in the woods. They want to get away from the objectifying eye of other personalities. They don't want to, because if you come upon, there's a famous myth a Greek myth, the goddess was, I don't think it was Athena, but anyway, it was a hunter, Artemis, no, he's a hunter, and he came up, he was following the stream up to its source, and he came to the source of the stream, and he saw the goddess bathing naked in the stream, in the pool, and he peered through the things with lust. And when she felt that lust, and she turned and looked at him, and turned him into a stag. And so his own dogs chased him down and killed him. But the meaning of that is that you can't look upon this goddess, this space here, in other words, we're getting back to lovers. Lovers don't want to be objectified in another person's eyes. The same way when I was a news photographer with the local paper, I discovered to be very careful when you were photographing a wreck or a family tragedy, because love and grief are the same. In the sense that you fall, when you somebody dies, you fall into a hole of grief. You know, so you're really outside of, you're in another dimension of now. You know, the grief is now. So I'm consumed by now. And if you come in and take a picture of me, I'm going to turn like that goddess, and I'm going to look at you and sick the hounds on you, you see, because you have objectified my soul. You have come in and made my grief an image. You see, you destroyed my love or my grief. So there's a lot of different implications of this, you know, where the personality, we live in a personality that sees everything as an it. That has a definition. So let's go up to this other experience. I had a great week, so. So this other thing, so last Saturday, my sister-in-law who lives in New Bern, it was her birthday, so we met at the Sylvan Bird Refuge in Scott, North Carolina. It was about an hour and a half from us. And the Sylvan Bird Refuge basically was created by somebody named Sylvan. And they have, through endowments and whatever, they have a refuge for waterfowl. And they have one of the largest collections of waterfowl in the world, and they also have a big breeding system there where they have some endangered species. But anyway, you go there, and the birds, and it's a habitat that is a habitat for both humans and birds.
Right.
So the birds have a realistic enclosure to live in with little ponds and water, and the humans get to walk around and open gates and go up into the areas with them, and then go out, and the humans close the gate themselves, and then there is a big net so the birds can't fly out. And all of the enclosures have birds from different parts of the earth. You might have Asian birds or African or whatever, and then you would have little plaques describing the birds in the enclosure. So most people go, including myself, and what the, it's kind of like connecting dots where you see, oh, look at that. Well, what is that? All right, so now I want to find, what is the meaning of that bird? So now I go find, oh, that is a cross-billed yadaha something, and it lives in Africa, and it does all these things, and now I know the bird. And then I go to this one, oh, I've never seen that bird, but what is that bird? All right, so immediately, you see, we got the bird is here with no definition, and I rush to name it from a name some anthropologist gave the bird 100 years ago when he first saw it, and wrote about it. So the bird is referred back to what I know. And now I can go on to another bird. I know all about that bird. So, see what I mean? So I'm not saying anything wrong with that. I'm just saying that that's the way, most this thing works usually. Everybody is connecting dots, and it's like a little puzzle, except it's real life. You connect the definition with the thing, and then you're done with it. So there's a little moment of curiosity, but just a little teeny moment of the unknown, a little teeny moment of the empty chair, and we rush to fill it in with the definition, and then we're satisfied, and we can go on. So we're constantly making the world certain and safe and known according to our past. So we're constantly making the present moment meaningful according to my past or my collective past or the society, you see. But then you come at a point like here, you see, there's no way to make it, there's no way to make it meaningful according to your past experience, because there is nobody there. I took this picture. I took some pictures. So this is interesting. I'm a photographer, a retired photographer, but I still have some lenses. So there's two kinds of lenses, basically. There's the wide-angle lens, which takes in everything. And then there's the narrow focus lens, which just goes in on the subject and the background blurs. So I took a bunch of pictures, and it was fun getting my lens out again. So anyway, this was a picture I took of one bird. But if you notice now we all know this, we all see this, particularly in portrait photography and whatever. But you have it's called a long lens or a narrow telephoto lens or whatever, and you can zoom in on the object and the background blurs out. So we like that because it really brings it separates the subject from its context. And it kind of like the image kind of like liberates the subject as an object from its field. So if you look at a bunch of birds in a cage, they're all jumping around, and you really can't. So you see the whole thing, and so then you can identify the different birds in there. But this kind of image separates the object so that it liberates the object from its object unto itself. So in a meditative way, the bird then kind of like becomes this thing here, where you, when you look at that, if you suspend, say, oh, that's a woodland duck, you know, and oh, and that woodland duck, then you can go, I looked it up in the dictionary, and you know, I know all about that duck, and I can tell you all about its habits and all that. That's one type of knowledge. But this kind of photograph opens up the possibility for another kind of knowledge, which is not reference to what you know about it. So if you meditate on that, you begin to a picture like this, if you meditate, the image of the duck then begins to have a being. Yeah, it begins to, in other words, with the eye, it begins to have a being in itself. It begins to be something that's luminous in the self, in the sense that it's not referenced to anything else. You don't get, well, God made the duck, and then you can talk about God making the duck, or you know, whatever. There's no reference to it. Yeah.
I was listening to Eckhart Tolle.
Yeah.
He related something that Krishnamurti said.
Yeah.
He said, as soon as you teach a child to dance a bird, they will never see a bird again.
Yeah.
Because they only have a concept of a bird.
Right.
They and then know you see what that. A bird is, they just know
right.
Bird.
Yeah, I think I'm glad you put that. That's what I'm pointing at, is that even ourself, you see, when we turn this against ourself, you see, who am I? We only know ourself according to the definitions that we've accumulated about who I am. You know, and so we don't really see ourself without any boundaries. So like this picture of the duck, when because the background is blurred, you see, it would be entirely different if you saw the background of the tree here or the woods or whatever you see. It wouldn't pop out. So this pops the foreground out, and there's nothing to reference it to. You can't, well, I don't know where he is. I mean, this duck could be anywhere, you see. So, but he stands alone. And it kind of like shifts us from seeing things in relevance to its context. And then we do this in TV imaging, you know, with the weatherman with the green screen. So we do this, you see it on YouTube, and now it's everywhere. Anybody can do it. You can get software to do it. But if you put a green screen behind something and you take a picture of me, you can change the background. You can put me in Egypt. You can make funny pictures of me and put me in peculiar positions, you know. And the background changes the meaning of me. So you put me in London, or you put me with, you know, you could put me anywhere, and it becomes a lot of fun, you know, because you change the meaning of the foreground when you change the background. But what if there's no background? You see, because if you have a green screen, you're changing the reference to who I am is reference to the background. So the background is in London or in the jungle with a, you know, or somewhere with Custer's Last Stand, and I'm standing out there with Custer, you know, whatever you put me in, you see, changes the meaning of me and the story of me. But when there's no background, then there's no story. So just the presence, the now, the presence leaps forth. It can, it may not, you may still, you know, and I'm not saying I'm getting a mystical experience off this, I'm just kind of using it as a metaphor about how our consciousness, you know. So this moment here is kind of like the without a background. See, so there was just now with no background projected onto it about what it meant. Because if I say God did it, that's a background. Or if I say an angel did it, I'm supplying the background to that, you see. Or if I said adrenaline did it, I'm supplying a background, you know, I'm putting adrenaline behind it. Now, that had meaning according to the adrenaline. Or if an angel did it, the meaning of it was according to the angel, you see. But if there's no background, it has no meaning. So now we're in a different dimension. There's no meaning, it's here, but I'm not applying any meaning to it. You see, so it's just here, so I'm just now. I'm just here, you know. And this is really where this practice is taking us, is just to be here and being okay with that. I'm just here. So if you make a mistake, it's not like, if you make a mistake in something, our normal would be to put a background in there of I'm incapable, or I'm stupid, or something's wrong with me, you see. So if we don't have any background, then there's no mistake. It's just something that happened, and we just move on. So like here, the other one didn't work. I didn't sit there and say, oh, I just can't get the thing to work, this damn thing, you know. Just, well, fine, we'll just use the eye, we'll just do the one and work with that. That's exactly what should have happened, you see. So every mistake in our life, when we don't put a background, is exactly what needed to happen. It couldn't have been any other way. It's when we put the background in there that it shouldn't have happened. It should have been another way. And then we get into a conflict with ourselves, you see, because now I can't make the world go my way. There's a when I was playing this chant when we came in called the Mula Mutra, but it's a chant to Satchidananda. Satchidananda is a Sanskrit word that means, Sat means being, Chit means knowing or consciousness, knowing, and Ananda means bliss. So Satchidananda means being, knowing, and bliss. So when Sat and Chit come together, you have bliss, or in an English translate, the peace that passes understanding. See, the peace that passes meaning. The peace that has no cause. Or the peace that has no reference. I'm peaceful because I just won the lottery. You see, now my peace is referenced to during the lottery. I'm unhappy now because I didn't win the lottery. So now my unhappiness is referenced to the fact that I didn't win the lottery. But the peace that passes understanding is peace that has no meaning. It has no cause. It has no reference. That's just happening. And so that peace that passes understanding happens when being and knowing come together. Normally, in our culture, these are split. Because being is all of this. In other words, all of us together, before we are selected out by our consciousness as something, is being. So we're all existence. We're all existence. We're all being. We are all this, you see. And then knowing, consciousness comes in and starts selecting things to know. So I select this and I'm conscious of the duck. And while I'm conscious of the duck, I'm not conscious of the iPad. But now I'm conscious of the iPad. And I notice that a woman just walked by, so now I'm conscious of her walking by, and I'm not conscious of this. So this consciousness is kind of like a searchlight that runs around selecting things to be conscious of out of being. So being is the ground out of which we select things to be conscious of. Or I can be conscious of myself as a thing, a personality. Or I can be conscious of, you know. So this consciousness is kind of like this flashlight shining around, you see. But these are separate, you see, in our reality map. And being in our reality map is dead, really is not alive. It's just material stuff. we can analyze it and say it's chemically made up of this, and it's got lead in it, and it's got all these things. So we can pull it apart analytically and see what it's made out of. But that's kind of like understanding a cow by slicing it up into steaks. You know what I mean? It's kind of like being. If you slice it up, you no longer have being. So if you slice the cow up, you might have a good steak, but you no longer have the cow. You see, so being can't be sliced up. In other words, it can't be defined. See, once you define something in being, you have selected it out and wrapped it up in what you know about it. But you, like a butterfly, you've pinned it to the wall, and now you know everything about that butterfly, but the butterfly is dead. See, so being is alive, but we kill it with our selective consciousness that defines it. So there's nothing wrong with defining it. I mean, we need to do that in order to catch a bus and do things. But at the same time, if we don't understand this other dimension, we live in a dead zone. Everything's dead. You know, so we run around trying to enliven things, you know, trying to have a good time, and trying to juice things up. But so when knowing and being come together, you have this. Because during that moment of driving, I was pure being, and I was knowing I was there, but I wasn't knowing I was there, I'm thinking about being there. I wasn't thinking about being there, or what was going to happen, or oh my God, or you know, yada yada. See, there was no thinking about it, but I was there. So in that brief moment, I was basically in, and also too, there, as I recall, there was no fear in that moment. There was no terror, because terror is part of the personality. You know, the personality is going to die, terror. There was no personality there. So there was no terror. And there was no peace in the sense that, oh, this is great. You know, there was no, I finally arrived. You know, so there was no peace in that sense, but there was no disturbance. It wasn't like, oh, this shouldn't be happening. There was none of that. There was nothing, yet I was totally there. So I use this kind of like as a metaphor, you know, as, because it is a common experience, that it points to the fact that this now, this undefined, this unbounded state of being is always present, but we overlay it with a culturally induced paint job of the known. So everything gets painted with what we know. Yeah.
Aren't you terrified?
No. And that's what I'm saying. You're driving along here in your personality, and suddenly there's lights right there, and the next instant you're going here, and there's noise, your car, the oncoming car is going like a subway train here, and the road, my hearing was very accentuated. So these sounds are very strong, and the sound of the gravel we hear. And then in the next instant, so this is about 2 seconds. So there's no, the terror would be coming in if I've got time to think about what was going to happen.
The outcome would have been totally different.
Yeah, I would probably crash.
Yeah.
Because that this happened so fast that there was no time to think. In other words, there was when you start thinking, there is going to be a gap between the brain brings in data And then the brain thinks, then the brain puts it into a context with me, and now you act or react. Well, that takes a millisecond for the brain to take the data, put it together in a hologram of reality, and now you've got to, now your personality has to decide what it's going to do. And if it doesn't know what to do, it's going to be terror, you know, because the personality says I'm going to die. Or that'll be I will die, there'll be the end of this personality, yeah.
But as soon as it was happened, then didn't you have terror thinking?
No, because there was no...
If I hadn't turned, no.
Like I said, when it was happening, we're talking about how long does it take? Go next time you go driving and you pass a car at 55 miles an hour, how long does it take for that car to go by you? You see? So I went by that car at the same... I didn't slam on the brakes. In other words, we passed each other at 55 miles an hour, but he was in my lane, full in my lane. So I got, you know, somehow I got the reaction. It wasn't, it was a response.
Right.
Now, Tolle talks about this, that when you're reacting from your personality, when you're reacting to something, you're reacting from fear, and you're in your personality. But when you are acting from here, from being, you are responding. And in Yoga Nidra, it says when you do some of these exercises, that at the beginning, when he sets you up, is that when you, as you welcome your personality, which is thinking, when you welcome that, your personality then becomes a guide to the ground of your being, and where you will find yourself responding perfectly to whatever needs to be done. See, so response is creative because the situation is new. Reaction is reacting, you see. So there is a time lag there. Reaction takes time. Response is instantaneous. So if there is a hot plate here, right, and I put my hand on the hot plate, and I use this all the time, and I smell something burning, I look down and say, oh, my hand's burning, should I take it off or not? I think I'll take it off. All right, so that's kind of like reacting, but if you put it there and you feel the pain, and as soon as you see it, you take your hand off. So there is no, that's a response. So we do this all the time. You respond instantaneously versus should I do it or not? You see? Or, you know, so the reaction out of fear is different from a spontaneous. So your difference here between spontaneity and control. So the personality, our personality wants to control our lives in the world to make it come out right. And when it can't, it has a fear panic attack. But this vertical dimension, our being, our presence is spontaneous. It's not controlled. It has no lesson plan. Because every moment is entirely new. You see, how can it be planned if you're in the moment, and the moment is spontaneous? The moment, every moment is spontaneously creating itself. But we meet the moment with our personality and our plan of what it should be, you know, what its meaning should be, you see. So we miss the moment, and we kind of like rush right over it, wanting to get to a better moment. So we're not living in the moment because we don't want to be here. We want to be in a better moment. You know, I want to get home, right? I'm dry. I want to get home. That's a better moment than sitting here in the car. Yeah.
So after this happened, you just simply changed lanes again and kept on going?
I didn't change lanes. I was back in my lane.
Well, no, but you were out of your lane.
I was out way over here.
And then you just changed.
And he was gone, and then I was back here. And I didn't even look in the lights to see if he was still on the road. And I said, well... Wow, that was interesting. Yeah, and I didn't, looking back, I didn't have oh my God, I almost died, and I gotta, I gotta go.
How did this happen to me?
You know, and all of this, you know, because then the personality comes back and imagines it could have been different. Well, it was, I could have died, you know. Now you're gonna have a terror, a fear attack, as if it, the lights were still coming at you. You see, so there wasn't any of that. My wife didn't even notice that she was doping off or something, I don't know. She didn't see the car or anything. You know, the next thing she knew, we were, all she knew that we were just swerved and we were, you know.
Oh, by the way, you almost died.
You know, she said, don't you know how to drive? Are you falling asleep?
So if whatever I am,
yeah,
is more my being or I aming,
yeah,
if really that's who I am,
yeah,
and all this personality and junk that I'm doing on,
yeah,
the surface is less than I am,
yeah, well,
then,
not, yeah, well, so just it's not all that you are,
right?
Yeah,
I'm more nothing than something, really, or I'm,
yeah,
more,
yeah, because what you're saying there is. This is undefined.
Right. Right, exactly.
So basically, all of us are undefined. We are the unborn, in the sense that when you're born, you're defined, you're in a family, you're in a religion, you're in, you're born American, whatever. You are, when you're born into a placemat of definitions, and then we begin constructing a personality with more definitions of who I am and my past and the children and the whole thing. And this is kind of like a big placemat that holds us, you know. And we're going off the falls of the end of time, you know. And so that the personality doesn't want to go, you know, because the personality believes it is real, but the personality is really not real, because the only thing that's real is right now. You know, so the personality lives in time, and now lives spontaneously now. And we drop into this off and on, but we really don't have an understanding or a map in which to understand what this means. So we give kind of like false meanings to it. You know, that's, I'm just lucky, fate, or adrenaline, or my lucky star, or whatever, but we don't have, and that's what I keep trying, what I do with myself, you know, what I try to do with this class, is to create an understanding or a context in which we can allow our greater self, our greater being, to come forth, you see, because as long as we don't believe it's there, it ain't coming out. See, as long as our belief system says it doesn't exist, you know, then I'm just a personality, you see, with all these defects and all that. We don't have the understanding in order to welcome our greater dimension. Yeah.
Hey, if this had happened when you were, say, 16 or 17 years old,
yeah,
would you have reacted the same before you had studied spiritual philosophy?
Well, I can't say it would, but this was not. Well, let me see how to put that. Now, I don't know whether my practice created this ability to respond so quickly or not. I really can't say. I do think, I made a talk out of this last year, I think. But I have a little Buddha pond, and it's got a little upper pond and a lower one. And then, it's like a big bathtub type of thing. Got some koi in it. So I'm up here fixing my pump, and my heel gets caught in a root, so that when I step back, I fall backwards, and I'm falling backwards onto these big rocks. But somehow I don't remember doing this. Again, I fell into this hole here. But when I went back like that, I turned in flight and landed like this, you know, so I didn't smash my head in the rock and fall into the pool and drown, which would have happened. If I hit the rock, I would have gone in the pond and drowned. So I like a cat, I turned in midair, but I don't have any remembering because it happens so fast, you know. So the personality can't keep up with that.
Well, that's where training comes in. I just got
Well, see, I'm not.
Well, but I mean,
yeah,
like
but I'm
this,
not an athlete. I'm in the sense that I'm trained to do
no,
that.
No, I mean this training, the way we can fall into the hole more often is through training. Just like a soldier, he doesn't get educated. He gets trained.
Yeah.
That when this happens, you do this. And so I'm getting that.
Well, the training comes in. Okay, that's a good point. The training comes in with the yoga nidra, and it says, welcome every perception. Well, that means I can't take this. That person's a goof off. I want to be in California. You know, whatever the perception is, you know, you're welcome. So there is no judgment on that. So that you're welcome, you are not judging the world according to your definitions of it. So if you don't judge, like the Bible says, if you don't judge the world according to your definitions, which is what judgment is, I judge you according to my definition of you, you see. So if you don't judge, you suspend judgment, you practice that, then you are practicing creating the availability of falling into the now.
Right.
Whether it's falling down the stairs or just dealing with your granddaughter, I don't know. You know, whatever it is, you know, if you deal with it from this non-defined place, you open up the moment to its potential to be complete. If you meet it with a definition, you open up the moment to be exactly what you think it should be, which is in a narrow definition of what it is, you see. You've not opened it up. So, this, in a sense now, this encounter with death, this there's another dimension to that, because the present moment is death. In the sense that now is death, in the sense that we can't define now. And the reason we fear death is because we can't define it. Well, we can't put it in the known. We can't put it in some context. It's like a big hole. You know, so nobody can go there and say what it is. So it's undefined. So, ironically, people will seek out this spontaneous awakening of being by playing with death, like we taught in extreme sports or whatever. You know, people will go get up close to death so they can awaken this. They get high on it. You know, it's not. It's more. It's adrenaline gets going. Yeah, but there's something else going on too. You know, in which they are totally now. When you go to an amusement park, you know, you get in a roller coaster. And you look at everybody screaming, you know, what are they screaming at, you know, when you look at it objectively. But when you're on the roller coaster, your personality is not there. It's just whipped you out of it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Our entertainment today in our culture is to find controlled ways to relieve us of our personality. It is so painful that we pay money to get out of it. A good movie takes us out of our personality.
Or music, or dance.
You know, whatever we can use, you know, some people get off on, you know, a tea ceremony, or whatever, you know, whatever you can use, people will provide it as an entertainment to make money on it, but the goal is to have a few brief moments of being free from my personality, to be free from time, and free from death. Because time and death are the same, you see. Death is not now, death is always in the next moment. But it's not there because the next moment is always now. In other words, now, time, what did I do with my thing? See, we think in terms of time like this, past, future, and I'm somewhere along here, you see. But when the now opens up, we are not, we have a sense of, we are now thinking about past and future. I'm not in the past, I'm not in the future, I'm always now. I can think about the past and the future, but I always stay grounded now, you see, and that changes the way we look at time. So, because if I don't have that vertical dimension, then I'm miserable about the past because I didn't do it right then, and I'm afraid I'm not going to do it right in the future, and I got all these worries, you know, regrets and grievances and worries about the future and all that. But in the now, there is no worry because there's no time. You see, so I'm just now, so it's okay. Now is okay. So now, so it's okay to think about the past and the future, but I don't, I'm not living there. I'm living now. See, so it shifts everything. The time doesn't go away, it just shifts the way we look at it. And we experience this as we age, you know, time changes. You know, so it's like it's a galloping horse running, you know. And that's okay, you know. So this whole practice too is being okay with aging. In other words, aging is. And when aging just becomes okay, then aging then blooms in wisdom and the peace that passes understanding. Anyway, thank you all for being so attentive and listening to my close encounter of the third kind. Okay. What'll I do next week?
Real quick. The same kind of thing happened to me. Oh, yeah, there's a Nat truck.
Oh, okay.
Across the side of the highway. And there were probably 20 cars that were going to smash all the roads. And they did. I couldn't go that somehow. We
I didn't want to
tell the car. And I had our side of the
That's why.
And after a minute, second, we all got Santa's hair. So it has nothing to do with it. It has exactly been present. And that group was very, what's scary? It wasn't anything was interesting, if anything. Because it seemed like it lasts, times like that. So it seemed like it lasts 5 minutes. We still talk about it. Yes. It's like one of the best things that's ever happened to me because it threw me into the present. And what listening to that is, because I don't know, I'm outside here. No, I'm practicing about being here now more and I'm doing it for practice. But then I start finding it and I get closer to it.